On April 9th of 1941, Liao Chengzhe received an urgent telegram from Yan'an. Mao Zedong demanded medical devices be shipped to the Yan'an Children's Nursery to deal with an outbreak of whooping cough. This would be a challenging assignment. The route from Hong Kong to inland areas was blocked by the Japanese army. The communist base at Yan'an was encircled by China's Nationalist Army. Sending medical equipment to Yan'an would seem to be an impossible task. The communist base at Yan'an in Shanxi province was short of essential supplies. It lacked money, grain, and military supplies. Communication equipment, munitions, medicine, and paper were a priority. Communication equipment was an essential item. During the long march, the Red Army broke through Kuomintang lines many times thanks to well-timed radio communications. For the Red Army, capturing a radio was almost as exhilarating as a battlefield victory.
The 抗日战争爆发以后，中国工农红军改编成八路军和新四军，当时全军共有34部电台，国民军政府 发了四部电台，还发了75部电话单机。这个很快，国民党就再也不给我们这个发通信器材了。Communist
leader Mao Zedong sent one unit after another to attack the enemy from behind. He wanted each regiment to have a radio, but there were only about 30 for the entire army. That meant there was only one radio for each division. In battle, units below the regiment level relied on signalmen and horses for communication. Chen Guang, chief of the radio department in the 8th Route Army's Chongqing office, noted that the new 4th Army once spent 3,500 silver dollars on a radio. Chen suggested buying components in Hong Kong, as the money spent on that single radio was enough to buy the parts for 10 radios. The home-built radios might look shoddy, but he could guarantee they would work. As head of the radio department, his suggestion was immediately reported to the central leaders.
周副主席亲自找我父亲，了解这个到香港采购这个电台的这个情况。我父亲说呢，准备用那个3万块那个大洋吧，准备购买80到100部电台。周副主席一贯对这个电台建设吧非常重视和关心，在这个中央资金非常这个紧缺的情况下吧，一下就批准了这笔资金。
Chen went to Hong Kong in early 1938, disguised as a merchant. The radios would be used for guerrilla warfare in the mountains. He told the Hong Kong Bureau the equipment couldn't be too heavy. He wanted good quality parts, and each kit should have all that was needed to assemble one radio. 3 months later, complete sets of parts for 100 small-scale radios, 40 hand-cranked generators, and a quantity of electronic valves were purchased. The next problem was getting them to where they were needed. The radio components were controlled items and difficult to move through customs.
廖承志主任亲自找到这个宋庆龄，当时宋庆龄吧住在这个香港，然后他的弟弟呢在香港九龙海关任监督，这个负责这个那个海关的工作。 所以宋庆龄特别关照他的弟弟，那个对于红军这批器材呢，给予免验免税，立即起运。
The equipment filled two trucks. After passing through customs, it was turned over to the Guangzhou office and then sent to Hankou by railway. The Wuhan office then transferred it to trains bound for Xi'an. In the early days of the war, this transport corridor from Hong Kong to Yan'an, or to Mount Wutai in Shanxi province, was called the Central China Channel. The Hong Kong office shipped its first batch of overseas aid supplies through this corridor. The radio components reached Yan'an safe in June 1938. Zhou Enlai was pleased. He immediately gave Shen another 30,000 silver dollars and sent him back to Hong Kong. With these two batches of parts, they could assemble nearly 200 radios. When he arrived in Hong Kong, Shen Guang discovered that getting the second shipment of parts to Yan'an would not be easy. The Japanese now occupied Guangzhou, and the railway line to Hankou was cut off. In November of 1938, the 8th Route Army's Wuhan office was forced to move to Guilin, and the Central China Channel was closed. Liao Chengzhe and his team decided to ship the parts through Haiphong in Vietnam and then north to Guilin. The Guilin office then had its soldiers escort the equipment through Sichuan province to Yan'an. The radio components arrived in the autumn of 1939 and were quickly assembled. Nearly 100 radios reached the battlefield in time for the 100 Regiment's offensive. The route from Hong Kong to Haiphong and then to Guilin was longer, but it was much safer.
通过这个车队，就是组成车队，还有是通过铁路。它的路线呢，一个是从桂林到柳州，再从柳州上到贵阳，再到重庆，然后由重庆把它转移到那个延安。另外一条路是从桂林到通过火车吧，到湖南，从湖南衡阳到江西，再到浙江，然后最后是到安徽新四军驻地。
In early 1939, trucks began carrying a large amount of supplies from Hong Kong to Yan'an. A Chinese group in Canada had donated 5 trucks to the China Defense League and asked that they be given to guerrillas in the Northwest. The League allocated over 5,000 Hong Kong dollars to assemble the trucks. The trucks were loaded with medicine, medical equipment, clothing, and food, and sent by ship to Haiphong. Then they were taken to Yan'an along the southwestern channel. The largest shipment of international aid supplies took place in the summer of 1939, as a dozen trucks carried 600 cases of medical supplies, including urgently needed X-ray equipment, paper, gasoline lamps, and other supplies from overseas were waiting in Hong Kong. A British industrialist had donated a new kind of ambulance equipped with operating rooms and hot and cold water. It was like a small-scale field hospital. Before its departure, Sung Chin Ling posed for a photo in front of it. But how would it reach Yan'an? Liao racked his brains and eventually figured out a way. To prevent it from being stolen and to exempt it from inspection, the office asked 2 foreigners to take it. New Zealand writer James Bertram and German doctor Hans Miller would drive the ambulance deep into China. Bertram wrote in his memoirs that he wasn't sure if the beautiful yet clumsy vehicle would make it from Haiphong to Yan'an along several thousand miles of rough roads. The rough and muddy roads of Guangxi in July were hard on the low chassis of the ambulance. Bertram took it to a repair shop to have the length reduced. Modifying the frame proved to be the right decision. This ambulance survived the rugged mountain roads and reached Guizhou in good condition.
Guiyang 到重庆这一带的这个交通，当时的这个交通状况比较差，很多地方呢。 要靠人拖马驮，人工搬运，那么运输当中呢，又容易出现各种险情。In
Guizhou, Bertram came down with malaria. He was given a folk remedy used by soldiers during the long march: raw green Chinese onions. Soon he forgot all about his illness. The more than 10-kilometer winding road through the Dalo Mountain was flanked with warning signs. The sharp curves left him too frightened to even sweat. At the bottom of some of the mountain passes, it was easy to see the debris of unlucky vehicles. The pair were in a state of near panic when they reached Sichuan. A month later, they parked the ambulance outside the Yan'an International Peace Hospital. There were too many checkpoints on the newly opened route, and it was often unusable due to Kuomintang roadblocks. Sung Chin Ling wanted to solve this problem and turned to her younger brother, Sung Sa Liang, for help. He was the director of the Department of Transportation of Southwestern China and supervisor of Kowloon Customs.
宋庆龄告诉他弟弟说：“我有几个车要过去，请你放行。”他弟弟就以为是宋庆龄的一些个私人的一些东西，或者是商业上要用的东西，就放行了。那么其实都是运给这个根据地的东西。另外一个就是他更多的是利用外国人。 因为国民党也好，当时的这些旧社会的这些人也好，对外国人是非常的害怕的，不愿意去得罪外国人的。那么恰恰他就利用这些个矛盾。Sung
Chin Ling often requested aid for China's Defense League's programs from overseas relief organizations, like United China Relief. The American Red Cross, British United Aid to China, and the first aid team sponsored by Society of Friends. These organizations helped the Hong Kong office transport supplies, and they were exempt from inspections on the road. China Defense League member Israel Epstein, a journalist, wrote an account of one convoy. The trucks were from the first aid team sponsored by the Society of Friends and escorted by two British relief workers. The trucks had 8 tons of medicine in crates marked with logos of American and British relief organizations. Epstein reported that the convoy was stopped at a checkpoint in San Yuan, not far from Yan'an. The supplies were moved to the British Baptist Church in the city, and the relief workers were informed the shipment could go to the Central Army Hospital, but not to hospitals used by guerrilla forces.
后来发现呢，也没有给陆军医院。 也没有用到伤兵身上，而是在西安的私人的药店里头发现，等于是作为一个黑市过来的东西给卖了。当然这个东西发现之后大家非常气愤，所以后来这个宋庆龄在纪念白求恩的时候曾经说过，就说当时白求恩为什么会逝世，他说是因为没有做手术的橡胶手套或者磺胺类制品，有一样那个白求恩就死不了了。
The checkpoint at San Yuan was just one along a 350-kilometer line established by the nationalist government. In January of 1940, Chiang Kai-shek launched a new campaign against the communists. One of his most trusted generals, Hu Zongnan, set up a blockade along the Shanxi, Gansu, Ningxia provincial borders in an attempt to isolate Yan'an.At the end of 1940, the Kuomintang launched a second campaign. By January of 1941, the blockade of Yan'an was even tighter. The supplies donated to the Hong Kong office couldn't be sent by truck anymore. Liao and Sung Chin-ling needed a new way to get supplies to Yan'an.They would turn to a special international organization for help. In May of 1939, Sung Chin-ling and Chen Hang-sheng had established the International Committee for the Promotion of Chinese Industrial Cooperatives, or the ICCIC, to drum up overseas aid for the war against Japan. A number of the Chinese Defense League witnessed the scene at one of the organization's fundraisers.Liao Mung-sing's mother guided the hand of Man Cam Lo of Jardine, Matheson and Company to write the amount of his donation. Other celebrities stood in line and awaited their turn. This fundraiser collected a large amount of money. By 1941, the organization had nearly 3,000 branches across the country and helped create employment for thousands.It was the last channel that might be able to help the Hong Kong Bureau transport supplies. Machinery bought by the ICCIC was transported to Northwest China from Shanghai. This equipment produced articles for daily use and also military supplies, including uniforms, army blankets, and weapons. The ICCIC helped the new Fourth Army to produce grenades and repair trucks and machinery. With the route to Yan'an now cut off, the nationalist government stopped providing funds for the ICCIC.The organization faced a crisis. To support it, in the summer of 1941, Sung Ching-ling and Liao launched the Bowl of Rice program in Hong Kong.
第一晚饭运动呢，是利用工业合作社的名义向进行，啊，那为什么要一定要用这个呢？因为呢？就是因为在这个特殊的社会环境下面，啊，我们不能公开说为抗战筹款。
This fundraising venture involved issuing 20,000 meal coupons, each worth $2 Hong Kong. Coupon holders could exchange them for a bowl of rice in designated restaurants.The first donor was Wen Jiaming, the owner of the Wellington Li Shan restaurant. He donated 500 bowls of rice. Other restaurants in Hong Kong soon followed his example. They thought of the rice bowls as national salvation meals.
有大米，有虾，有鸡肉，有叉烧，有鸡蛋，这么一碗炒饭。一碗炒饭2块钱。
Each coupon was good for several different dishes, but holders could only have one in each restaurant. The profits were given to the ICCIC to help refugees in northwestern China. On the evening of August 1st, 1941, thousands crowded into the street in front of the Ying King Hotel to buy a bowl of rice. Newspapers published photos, and slogans and banners appeared in front of restaurants about the National Salvation Meals. Signs calling on people to help homeless refugees appeared on the side of buses. Business, industry, women, and student organizations all helped to promote the coupons.
香港的月鲜酒家，这个桌子上摆了三个碗，就是这三个壶，三个碗。当时在报道中说是三个古碗，因为一般的这一碗饭呢是两块钱港币，而这个大碗的饭是说一斤的米、四两叉烧、四两虾仁儿，还有等等一些东西，然后做成一碗饭。这一碗饭要卖100港币，而且由老板亲自给盛，这作为一种很高的规格。
The event was planned for 3 days, but continued for a month. After deducting all the costs, the campaign raised 25,000 Hong Kong dollars and 615 yuan. All the money went to help wounded soldiers and refugees. In the 8 years of war against the Japanese, the 8th Route Army received millions in cash and supplies. The vehicles donated through the Hong Kong Bureau were sufficient to equip 3 divisions and 50 medium-sized rescue teams. Chinese living in the Philippines and America donated 50 aircraft, enough to equip 2 divisions. They also donated over 3,000 batches of medicine, medical equipment, and war supplies. In addition to raising donations, the writers, reporters, and volunteers of the Hong Kong Bureau gave the world news of the conditions faced by the communist armies. Join us again as we bring you the stories of these courageous individuals. Join us for part 3, number 18, Queen's Road.